Chapter 22 of The Crippled God by Stephen Erickson. Wow, what a chapter. There is no time now for thoughtful, philosophical moments inside people's heads. We are just going right into the action. This chapter was phenomenal. So started out with calm perspective. Book, we haven't known her motivation. We know that she's not with sort of the regular forklift sale plan. And so there was some suspicions, at least by me, that she might be like drifting toward the human side. That's definitely not the case. Her plan is basically like the Joker. She just wants to watch the world burn. Thinks justice is total annihilation. And her plan to do that is for Ikarian to eventually face the Eliant, or the dragons as a whole. Calm's internal working is so interesting, and she reveals to us something of Ikarian. If she's right, we don't know if she's correct in her thoughts, but she sees Ikarian as like the power of chaos itself. And when he is filled with rage, that is what comes through. And that would be a very interesting reason, because it's always been sort of a mystery. Why is Ikarian cursed, and why is he this powerful? And it's just sort of something we've accepted. And I like that the reason has been given that it is that he is like a pathway that chaos uses to come into the world through his rage. Pretty sucky plan, but we'll see what happens. It's also interesting, I should mention, this is another great thing I think about Malazan. There are so many powerful beings that have plans, and they all are trying to do their different plans and are very cocky about their plans working. And like a lot of them don't work, which sounds like very like obvious, but in most stories, and I think again, this is a postmodern critique, like there's one big overarching master plan by someone and like you're waiting to find out what it is, or you wanna like get it unveiled. But in Malazan, there are several powerful people, both villains and good people, who have plans that are convoluted, that they want to work and often don't. Like even in this chapter, we see at the beginning, the main reason Calm is getting to Ikarian is because she's afraid Korobas will kill all the Eliant, and then there's no one who's going to stop them from killing the Forkula Sail. But we know by the end of the chapter, the Eliant are more than enough to kill Korobas, and she's dealt with Rout, not easily, but she's dealt with by the Eliant, so it's not necessary. And so it's gonna be interesting to see how her motivation changes, if she senses that, all that kind of stuff. So the Calm storyline, it's really short at the beginning, is great. Next up is Kilimandros and Sekel Lash. I've never said that out loud. Knuckles, let's just call them Knuckles. Meet their sad end, although they're not really like heroes, so I'm not really sad about their death, but we see Draconis finally sort of in all his power because he takes down Kilimandros so easily. I love that this is sort of the justice. I mean, this feels like Anomander Rake. Draconis sort of taking that onto himself, as poetic as it is that he has a sword similar to Dragnapur, that he is now taking justice on these Elder Gods. And it seems clear from this that he is now going through and trying to kill the Elder Gods. The Elder Gods were trying to kill the Ascendants. Draconis is trying to kill the Elder Gods, and it's clear that he is sort of the most powerful actor at play here. Through a dialogue later on with Silkus Ruin and his friend, the Undead Dragon, we kind of learn that eventually when Draconis is done with that, they think one of the motivations that Anomander Rake did what he did was so that Draconis would be the honorable man that he was, see what needed to be done and do that. And we're not really sure what that is, but that seems to fit with our picture of Draconis, and we've gotten to know him a little bit while he was in Dragnapur. Dragnapur's Warren, and we do sympathize with him a little bit, even though we're unsure of him. So that all makes sense that Draconis is going to have a very important role at the end of this convergence. There's a great conversation of Shadowthrone and Cotillion with Draconis, which underscores what I just said, that Shadowthrone bargains with Draconis. I love that, by the way, side note, that Shadowthrone is called the Usurper by so many people. I just think that's a cool title for like who he is and what he has done. I also interesting, this is the first time Shadowthrone has referenced himself as Kelanved. Kelan, he's talking about his mom, calling him Kelan, so that's very interesting and new. Again, Shadowthrone and Cotillion are in the middle of this plan, and it is them. And it's great that those gods that we sympathize with are at the middle of this, and they have brought in people like Hood and Anomander Rake, these most powerful beings, to the design of gods, but gods who are somewhat human. That's a great picture, I think, of the Malazan Empire, but also the series as a whole. We have a little bit of a reemergence of Opon. We see the twins, not necessarily grieving, but visiting their dead father, Knuckles, and it seems like they have a part to play as well. So they're in the game now, and there is a reference again to Gardens of the Moon, and that's spinning coin. So excited to see where that goes. Then the rest of the awesome chapter is Perrin and Quickben and Kalam, and this feels so good. I mentioned in my Toll the Hounds review, which you should watch if you haven't, it's spoiler free. At this point, the spoiler review is coming soon, but I mentioned that going to get a Bacchus and Toll the Hounds feels like home when you first read it, because Daruja-stan is where we first went. And in the same way, Quickben and Kalam teaming up to take down powerful enemies, again, just kind of feels like home. It feels like, this is old school Malazan Book of the Fallen, them doing what they're doing, taking out Forkerless Sail, taking the power of the voice away so that the Watered and the other Kulanzi are easy to take out. Delightful is not the right word, because it's war and there's some gruesome stuff that happens, but it feels so good to be back in this place and to have those characters back doing what they're doing. It's great to see Perrin at like the height of his powers doing amazing things and being respected both by his men and the sappers. It's just great. Love sappers always. And then, I know I'm rushing through this, but all these battles are so great. And then there's this great war in the pass between the Parish Greyhelms, who are like at the top of the pass, and then the Kulanzi troops that are at the front trenches. And they've dug in, made it basically impossible for the Malazans to be able to attack, at least that's what they think. And then we see again the glory of Malazan Marines and Maranth munitions. It's a great, as usual, Erickson is great at military fantasy and describing this battle in amazing ways, and it's incredibly quick, which so draws you in to the action and what is happening. I should have mentioned before this, we get a great moment where Kalam assassinates, with Quickben's help, the ranking Forkerless Sail, who's one of the highest Forkerless Sail in the whole unit. And we again see sort of the hubris of Forkerless Sail being their downfall, and that leading to this destruction. The battle itself in the past really reminds me of Deadhouse Gates. Sometimes the battles, as you think of them, sort of blend together in Deadhouse Gates, but there's one very particular one. I don't know if it's a pass, but it's the one where there's a slight incline where the Malazans have to go up, and it is the sappers who dig in overnight and cause the explosion that allows them to win. This feels very similar to that battle. It's really well done. Again, the writing is beautiful, even in its terror, because it's war. The one thing we do have is them sparing the Greyhelms. They surround them. Another great move by Perrin. As master of the deck, he's able to open these huge warrens, even in this area that so far has not been able to have other warrens other than that of the Forkerless Sail. So we see his power, which is, again, always great to see with this character that has grown with us. And then finally, we get the surrender of the Parish Greyhelm. So that whole sequence, I'm describing a lot of it, it's like 80 pages, is phenomenal. An amazing, amazing sequence. And then we finally end up like a cherry on top of this beautiful Sunday of a chapter with a humongous dragon battle. Storms of dragons are fighting each other, but also are converging to try to kill the Otaratil dragon Korabas, and they do, but before that, Korabas takes out like a bunch of them in this just gruesome battle in the sky filled with no sorcery, obviously, because of the Otaratil, just like teeth and claws and hides, and it is just brutal, but like nothing I've ever seen in a fantasy novel. I've seen a lot of dragons, nothing like that. Normally, fantasy authors like to like keep dragons at a distance, and like one or two are part of the story. And this is just literally multiple storms of dragons fighting in the air. I imagine it in like a Twister of dragons, and it is, oh, fantastic. This is a fantastic, fantastic chapter. Cheers to you, Steven Erickson. Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Let me know what you thought of this great chapter. I know you loved it, but maybe let me know more specifics about things that you remember or love about this. Is this the best chapter in the book? Is it the best chapter in the series? Man, so excited to go read some more. First in, last out. Be sure to subscribe.